Good morning, everyone. Thank you all for coming. My name is Victor Chime, Senior Advisor and Korea Chair here at the Center for Strategic and International Studies and Professor at Georgetown University. And we're very happy to welcome you here to the Korea Global Forum 2014, which we are doing co-hosting in cooperation with the East Asia Institute. And Dr. Suk Jung Lee of the East Asia Institute will offer some welcoming remarks in a moment. this morning we have really an I think unprecedented and unique combination of speakers in Assistant Secretary Russel and in the Unification Minister, as well as Deputy Secretary Rich Armitage, who will be joining us later this morning. So to start us off, the first thing we'd like to do is show you all a video that CSIS produced that is a bit of a summary of a three-year project that we have been doing on unification. It's a very short video just to get us started. So if we can, and I'm sorry, we don't have the big screen, so you're all going to have to look this way to watch the video. So whoever is rolling the video, go ahead and roll it.
Korean unification is a question of when, not if. Whether sudden through the collapse of the North or gradual through increased contact between the two sides, unification will be a challenge. However, it'll also present an opportunity to generate growth and peace in Asia. Regardless of the speed of unification, there are medium to longer term issues to tackle in knitting the two societies together. A first-of-its-kind groundbreaking study looked at past examples of unification-related and state-building tasks in several countries. The lessons learned unveiled five key lessons for Korean unification. 1. Internal migration will be more chaotic than external migration. Conventional wisdom is that refugees will flood across Yalu and Tumen rivers to China, and others will seek to move south. However, migration experts find that people generally don't want to leave their homes, especially if they have food and feel that they're secure. Those who know someone who successfully migrated are likely to move, but since most North Koreans don't know anyone who did, high migration outflow isn't guaranteed. The bigger problem will be internally displaced persons as people try to come to the city or look for family members. This will stress already vulnerable food and security systems, which means having plans to provide food and security quickly in the North post-unification will be critical. 2. Reestablishing a health infrastructure will be challenging. Despite a state health system, North Korea struggles with significant disease problems, including measles, TB, smallpox, and cholera, among others. The average height of a 7.5-year-old North Korean boy is approximately 3 inches shorter as compared with his South Korean counterpart. The average weight of a 7.5-year-old North Korean boy is approximately 7.3 kilograms less than his South Korean counterpart. Experts from efforts in other regions stressed restoring the health infrastructure is a top priority for unification to limit disease and to gain the trust of the North Korean people. However, solutions cannot be imposed from outside. They must be tailored to the situation at hand, and doctors have to work with whatever coping mechanisms North Koreans have developed. Currently, NGOs have been successful locally in North Korea, but they will need help scaling up to a national level. 3. Transitional justice must be viewed as reconciliation, not revenge. The common view is that all of the North Korean bad guys in the party, military, and intelligence circles should be prosecuted and thrown in jail. However, countries such as South Africa and Mali show that this is not the ideal solution. Justice that seeks high-profile acts of vengeance will not create reconciliation. It will create an us-versus-them attitude and breed fear. Yes, some will go to jail, but others should be offered alternatives. For example, the nuclear director should be prosecuted to the fullest extent. but perhaps amnesty could be given to scientists in order to learn important details about the clandestine nuclear program. 4. Economic opportunity could exist under the shambles. Most think the North Korean economy is in shambles and that unification will be too expensive. It is true that the average South Korean is about 25 times richer than the average North Korean. In comparison, at the time of unification, West Germans were about twice as rich as East Germans. To this day, Germany is still working to achieve economic equality. However, the economic situation may not be that dire, and potential does exist in North Korea. It has significant natural resources and relatively high social capital, including education, literacy, and urbanization. In a unified Korea, the North's literate labor force could be married up with the South's capital and management. We have seen pockets of such potential in Kaesong. The greatest underestimated resource is the entrepreneurial potential of the North Korean people, which is very high as evidenced in the growth of formal and informal markets. 5. Unification as a driver of regional peace and cooperation. Unification needs to be led by Koreans with support from the United States as well as other regional powers. The spectrum of support might range from strong, U.S., to reluctant, China. However, U.S., Chinese, Japanese, and Russian experts in the project all agreed that the process of unification needs to end not in a system of 19th century balance of power politics, but in a 21st century security community. Laying the groundwork of support now will ensure that unification will be a driver of peace and cooperation for the region. The potential of unification to bring North Korea fully into Northeast Asia promises short-term costs, but unification can also offer an enormous upside that can benefit the entire region.
No need for you to clap. That's fine. So that video will be posted on the CSIS website. There's a book that's attached to that video that will be coming out probably in the next year or so, but you'll be able to see it on the website. I would now like to introduce our co-host for this event, Professor Sukjong Lee, who is president of the East Asia Institute.
Good morning. Hi. Mr. Minister Ryoo, who will arrive shortly, and Honorable Assistant Secretary Daniel Russel, and the EAI Chairman Hayoung Sung, and also former Deputy Secretary General, Secretary Richard Armitage, who will arrive shortly as well, and distinguished guests. I'd like to welcome everyone. And on behalf of East Asia Institute, I'd like to welcome everyone to the Korea Global Forum. And this forum was established to discuss issues related to the unification of the two Koreas and also to seek international support for our efforts to become one Korea again. It is our great pleasure to be able to bring this forum to the great city of America and look forward to learning much through this unique opportunity. To the peaceful unification of the two Koreas is an existential issue for Koreans, in which we desire to see the restoration of a unified Korean ethnic nation states. As we share historical memories, a common language, ancestor, and cultural roots, the division of the Korean Peninsula into two different political systems remains but a short interlude in the Korean history, a history that spans many millennia. The road to unification is weighed down by many challenges, including how to reconcile different ideologies and how to best integrate two Koreas, which are very utterly different political and economic systems. However, we believe that unification will install permanent peace on the peninsula, which is important for all nations who have a stake in the Northeast Asian region, such as your own. Unification will also improve the lives of our brothers and sisters in North Korea, bringing about major economic benefits for both sides. We don't know when unification will occur and what kind of path unification will take. The only thing we can do is prepare. In this spirit, President Park Geun-hye recently launched her presidential committee to explore ideas and feasible projects that can help facilitate economic, legal, and sociocultural integration of the two Koreas. Although unification is essentially a Korean prerogative and responsibility, I believe that it matters to international society a great deal. Outside of Korea, unification is most significant to the United States, I think, and we think. As a peacekeeper on the Korean Peninsula and in the Northeast Asian region at large, and also USA as a champion of human rights and humanitarianism, American leaders and her public would have a keen interest in the task of uniting two Koreas. Considering the importance of the cross-alliance relationship between South Korea and the USA, advice and assistance from our American friends and colleagues is central in bringing to guide the unification process. Therefore, the two subsequent addresses by Assistant Secretary Daniel Russel and our Minister Yoo Kyung-jae are very timely and will be invaluable in stimulating our thoughts and discussions. Let me close my welcoming remarks by thanking Dr. Victor Cha and his staff at CSIS for organizing this forum together with the EAI. And they have been simply marvelous, and it was a great pleasure to work with them. Thank you.
Thank you, Suk Jung. It really is a pleasure to partner with EAI, the East Asia Institute, on this project. So thank you very much. Now I'd like to introduce our speaker for this morning, Assistant Secretary Daniel Russel. As many of you here know, he is the Assistant Secretary of State for East Asian and Pacific Affairs, is a career member of the Foreign Service, and probably the most experienced person on Asia in the Obama administration today. Prior to his appointment as Assistant Secretary in 2013, Danny served as the White House as the Special Assistant to the President and at the National Security Council as the Senior Director for Asian Affairs, as well as a Director for Asian Affairs for Japan and Korea. Before joining the NSC in January of 2009, he served as Director of the Office of Japan Affairs and had assignments as U.S. Consul General in Osaka, Kobe, Deputy Chief of Mission at the U.S. Embassy at The Hague, Deputy Chief of Mission at the U.S. Embassy in Cyprus, Chief of Staff to the Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, Special Assistant to the Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs. For those of you who don't know State Department, like, this is like the elite. He is like, has all the top positions. In addition, so a great deal of experience in both Japan and Korea, but also outside of there, and also had the honor of serving as advisor to the ambassador to Japan and former Senate Majority Leader Mike Mansfield. Mr. Russel is educated at Sarah Lawrence College and University College, University of London. So it's our pleasure this morning to welcome Assistant Secretary Russel. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you, Victor. Thank you, Dr. Lee, Chairman Ha. It's a pleasure and an honor for me to be part of the same program as Minister Liu and Rich Armitage, a friend and a mentor. It's also a pleasure to be at CSIS. CSIS really does an extraordinary job in terms of policy development, stimulating new thinking, generating scholarship, just as we've seen on the video earlier, and also providing a critical eye and critical feedback on the implementation of U.S. foreign policy, which we appreciate, and particularly we appreciate the fact that it's bipartisan, frankly nonpartisan feedback, which is essential to us. I also want to express my support and respect for the East Asia Institute, which is an important voice from the Republic of Korea. Your input helps us in the administration to foster and to engineer our policy, our strategy, our rebalance in ways that reflect not only American interests, but the interests of our partners of the region and of the world. So I thank you. We're closing in on the holiday season, which is a very appropriate time for a conference on unification because it's a season of hope. And we all hope and work in an effort to address the most troubling and difficult vestige of the Cold War, the division of the Korean Peninsula. Now, for my part in the State Department, this fall has been a period of transition. The team in the State Department that helps the President and the Secretary formulate and policy and manage our vital relationship with Korea has undergone some changes. President Obama, to our surprise, stopped by Ambassador Lippert's swearing-in ceremony at the State Department a month ago to wish him well and to wish him off. Mark's off to a great start in Seoul. He's already found a sort of magic charm to introduce himself and his family to the Korean people, his now famous Basset Hound, Grigsby, who's a media rock star in Korea. And Mark's predecessor, Ambassador Sung Kim, a very respected diplomat and a dear friend of mine, I'm glad to say is back in Washington in a new dual-hatted role, both as the special representative for North Korean policy, but also as the deputy assistant secretary of state for Korea and for Japan. And someone you know well, Sid Seiler, has moved over from the NSC and is now our special envoy for the six-party talks. I won't belabor the biography because these people are very well known to you all, but suffice it to say that we've filled successfully the big shoes of Jim Zumwalt and Glenn Davies. And in the State Department, we joke that we've built our K team, the Korea team, with our A team. So as the season, holiday season approaches, and as the year draws to conclusion, it's a time for us to reflect on the accomplishments and the challenges of 2014. It's also a time to look forward to the prospects for the new year. And so as you begin your program today, I want to share my thoughts on the U.S.-ROK relationship and share my thoughts on how we are meeting and how we will continue to meet the regional and the global challenges together and on the Korean Peninsula and on the future of the Korean Peninsula as well. In short, it's really been a remarkable year in the U.S.-ROK relationship, and that comes on top of a series of very successful years in which an already close relationship between us has grown even closer. This year, in 2014, I think we've strengthened our alliance, we've increased trade and investment, and we've worked more seamlessly than ever on challenges all around the world. And looking ahead, 2015 clearly is shaping up to be another very significant year. But let me just do a quick overview of 2014, if I may. In January, we concluded an agreement that provides important resources to sustain the presence of U.S. forces in Korea for many years to come. And I'll offer more on that in a moment. In April, I had the honor of accompanying President Obama when he visited the Republic of Korea for an unprecedented fourth time, reaffirming our alliance and our global partnership, as well as the close personal ties between our two presidents. In October, we updated the framework governing the transfer of operational control of alliance forces during wartime, OPCON transfer, and I'll come back to that also in a moment. And we had a very productive 2+2 meeting in which Secretaries Kerry and Hagel hosted their ROC counterparts, Ministers Yun and Han. That was only the third meeting of its kind. And at the same time that the foreign and defense ministers were meeting, our Secretary of Commerce, Benny Pritzker, was in Seoul with an important trade mission. And then in November, during President Obama's second Asia trip of 2014, he again had the opportunity to confer in depth with President Park on the margins of APEC, of the East Asia Summit, and of the G20. Throughout the year, we've also made significant progress in implementing the U.S. Korea Free Trade Agreement, CORUS FTA. This agreement helps ensure that our two economies continue to provide a foundation of shared prosperity that strengthens all aspects of the relationship. And our growing partnership also benefits from the large number of Korean students studying in the United States, as well as Americans studying in Korea. And that number is up an eye-popping 300% over just the last decade. Last year, South Koreans were the ninth largest group of visitors to the United States, spending something on the order of $6 billion while they're here. And in the realm of energy security, we're finalizing a successor civil nuclear agreement, what's called a 1-2-3 agreement, that reflects the Republic of Korea's major status as a global nuclear supplier. And that agreement also reflects the tremendous importance that we both place on nonproliferation, on nuclear security, and on nuclear safety. So out of all these accomplishments, what I want to come back to and highlight are the two that modernize the workings of our alliance. The first is OPCON transfer, which is hugely important to South Koreans as well as to us. The new framework for OPCON transfer puts us on a path that takes into account the critical defense capabilities needed on the Korean Peninsula, as well as the evolving security situation on the peninsula and in the region. The second thing that I mentioned in modernizing the alliance is the Special Measures Agreement, or the SMA. This is the agreement that ensures that there will be continued ROK resources available to troops from both nations to ensure that we have the capabilities, as the commander of U.S. Forces Korea is fond of saying, to fight tonight if needed. These agreements aren't flashy, they're not necessarily big news, but they're hugely important because more than six decades after the armistice along the 38th parallel, the North Korean threat, the military threat, clearly still remains. And even as we hope, plan, and prepare for a brighter, more peaceful, and united future for the Korean Peninsula, we must still guard against the perils of the present. And these perils include, of course, North Korea's nuclear weapons programs, North Korea's missile programs. They include also the risk of conventional and cyber attacks. But they also include challenges such as natural disasters, which are becoming more frequent and more costly. And they encompass threats from violent extremism like ISIL, from global health threats like Ebola, and from climate change. These are global challenges that affect us all. The U.S.-ROC alliance is evolving to meet these challenges and more, while safeguarding and promoting South Korea's emergence on the global stage. That emergence requires modern bases, it requires stable funding, and it requires the continued development of the ROC's critical military capabilities that the SMA and the OPCON agreements help to provide. And beyond our bilateral relationship, it's been a dramatic year for the ROK's relations with the world and our global work together. In March, in Dresden, President Park Geun-hye laid out a comprehensive vision for peaceful reunification. In July, Chinese President Xi Jinping became the first president of the PRC to visit Seoul before visiting Pyongyang, or without ever having met the North Korean leader. The significance of this fact is crystal clear to all of you. I don't have to belabor it. But I would add that the impact and the importance of President Xi's visit to Seoul was augmented by the firm and the solid policy pronouncements and statements that President Park herself made during that visit. And as 2014 went on and the dangers from the Ebola virus and from ISIL heated up, South Korea stepped forward to respond. It contributed funding to each of these fights and is even now preparing to send a group of health workers into the Ebola hot zone in West Africa this month. Later in October, the ROC hosted the conference of the ITU, the International Telecommunications Union, which produced the Busan Consensus. And this was South Korea's first year hosting the secretary of the new UN Green Climate Fund. And the ROK has pledged $100 million to that fund. And as President Obama's recent pledge of $3 billion to that fund shows, the U.S. places an immense importance on this global initiative. And very importantly, the ROK is wrapping up a historic and a successful two-year stint on the UN Security Council. You know, it's really remarkable when you take a step back and think about it. 25 years ago, the Republic of Korea wasn't even a full member of the UN. But at that time, a certain young diplomat named Yoon Byung-se set out to change it. And I happen to remember it because I had the privilege of working with him back in 1990. We worked together on a strategy that ultimately got Russia and China to go along with making both Koreas full members of the UN. That also led directly to the process of normalization between Seoul and Moscow, as well as Beijing. Now, barely a quarter century later, a South Korean is the Secretary General of the UN. The Republic of Korea is on the Security Council. And over the past 2 years, South Korean diplomats led discussions in the Security Council on a whole range of pressing topics, how to protect civilians in armed conflict, how to counter proliferation of chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear weapons. Now, when it comes to nuclear weapons, no country lives closer to the threat than the Republic of Korea. And let me briefly mention what we have done about the North Korean threat in 2014, both in terms of our efforts to curb the threat from the North's nuclear and ballistic missile program, but also our work regarding human rights. On the nuclear issue, I've already mentioned the military pillar of our strategy and how we are modernizing the alliance. There's also, you could say, an economic pillar and a diplomatic pillar to our work. And that means that we've strongly supported new Security Council sanctions and increased global enforcement of the sanctions and the resolutions in order to block proliferation and stem the illicit activities that fund or support North Korea's nuclear and missile programs. At the same time, we're working with our partners to show the North Korean leadership convincingly that a diplomatic path is open to them. We've gone the extra mile to reach out to the North Korean leadership and encourage it to engage in authentic and credible negotiations. But for a negotiating process to have any realistic prospect of succeeding, there are conditions that it is reasonable and necessary for North Korea to meet. These are conditions simply in line with the commitments, the important commitments, that the DPRK undertook in the September 2005 joint statement of the six-party talks. The bottom line is this. North Korea can never achieve the security and the prosperity that it desires while also pursuing nuclear weapons. This concept of Byungjin, the notion that North Korea can somehow develop its economy while it's also continuing to develop nuclear and missile offensive capabilities, it's not a policy, it's a pipe dream. It will not happen. North Korea can't have its cake and eat it too. Our strategy raises the cost of continued defiance and ultimately leaves the DPRK no viable alternative but to honor its commitments and to come into compliance with its international obligations, first and foremost with its obligation to irreversibly and verifiably denuclearize. Now, at the same time in the course of 2014, the U.S. and the ROK worked with international partners on behalf of the North Korean people to shine a light on the North's human rights horrors and to highlight the responsibility of its country's leaders for that tragedy. In February, the Landmark Commission of Inquiry report laid out these violations in really devastating detail. And in September, Foreign Minister Yoon and Secretary Kerry joined the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, Zaid, and Japanese Foreign Minister Kishida in a multilateral high-level event on the margins of the UN General Assembly focusing on human rights, the first ever such event at the UN General Assembly. And after that, the UN's Third Committee passed a resolution encouraging the Security Council to consider referring the DPRK to the International Criminal Court, the ICC, based on the facts documented in the Commission of Inquiry's report. The full General Assembly will be taking up this resolution, and North Korea is clearly starting to feel the heat. Their statements pushing back on this pressure have amplified to a near daily drumbeat of blasts in the past few months. This year, they even felt the need to send their foreign minister to New York at the UN General Assembly for the first time in some 15 years as part of an apparent charm offensive around the world. So clearly, our bilateral and our multilateral solidarity across this range of issues forms the basis on which our security is protected, our values are advanced, and ultimately, the Korean Peninsula can be peacefully unified. But it's also important to note that U.S.-ROC cooperation and the ROC's global role go way beyond the problems of the DPRK. Secretary Kerry said it in October. The Republic of Korea has emerged as a key global player, dedicated, as the United States is, to universal values like human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. So South Korea, along with Japan and Australia and others, is a key U.S. partner in the regional institutions that help apply these values and make them real. We see, for example, the emergence of global Korea in the ASEAN format, including the ASEAN plus three group, as well as in APAC, as well as in the G20 and elsewhere. I think in just a couple of hours, the ASEAN ROK summit opens in Busan, celebrating 25 years in that relationship. And as leaders from every part of society across the region are debating and discussing the future of the Asia Pacific, President Park has put forward her Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperative Initiative, as well as the concept of trust politique. Now, the achievements of the year that's drawing to a close form a springboard for us for the work that we seek to undertake in 2015. And there's some real opportunities and some unique challenges coming up this next year. And let me touch quickly just on three: climate, health, and water as examples. With the Paris meetings on climate change coming up, 2015 will be a big year for the greatest challenges we face as a planet: climate change. And South Korea, as the host of the Green Climate Fund, can do a lot. In light of the Ebola virus, 2015 will be a big year for global health security. South Korea is an important player as host, of the high-level global health security agenda meeting. And as we face water challenges from the Mekong to the Maldives to the Middle East, South Korea is hosting the Triennial World Water Forum, a hugely important gathering of tens of thousands of water policymakers and practitioners. But next year will be an extremely important year for a fourth reason. That reason is history. And it is our fervent hope that 2015 will be the year when the historical anniversaries in Asia become milestones and cease to be millstones. We will, as you know, mark the 70th anniversary of Korean independence, which of course coincides to the 70th anniversary of the division of the peninsula at the end of World War II. This coincides also with the 50th anniversary year of the normalization of diplomatic relations between the Republic of Korea and Japan. And as two democracies, two free market economies, two key allies of the United States, I can't overstate the importance that we place on strong, healthy, good relations between the Republic of Korea and Japan. I'm hopeful that we will see progress this year on sensitive issues and important legacy issues, and an enduring improvement in overall relations. Fostering that improvement is a priority for the United States. Now, I've spoken at length about the vitality of the USROK alliance and the extensive global partnership that we enjoy, and I've done so because these provide the context to thinking and planning for Korean unification. The most problematic legacy of World War II, this great divide, is the separation of North and South Korea, which is, of course, the focus of your work today. As President Obama said in Seoul when we visited in 2012, the currents of history cannot be held back forever. The deep longing for freedom and dignity will not go away. The day will come when the Korean people, at long last, will be whole and free. In the meantime, the U.S. strongly supports President Park's policy on unification. She's extended an open hand to the North and proposed a step-by-step trust-building process. She's appropriately balanced pragmatism and principle. She's founded the Unification Committee, which, along with Chairman Ha, visited Washington earlier this week and held consultations with me and my colleagues at the State Department. She's painted a vivid picture of the benefits that the North Korean people could reap from steps towards reconciliation and denuclearization, as well as the benefits that reunification will bring to South Korea, as well as to the region. The United States firmly supports this vision. We will never accept a permanent division of the Korean Peninsula. So the ROK and the United States will continue to do everything we need to do to keep the peace on the peninsula through a combination of deterrence and a strong allied defense. We will continue to maintain stability in the region to promote universal values and human rights. And we will continue our cooperation to build broad-based and sustainable economic growth. All of these steps help in the preparation for unification. So Let me end simply by saying sincerely thank you for your efforts here in the conference that you're embarking on today. The work you're doing on unification is important. For one thing, these meetings and this conference allow leading thinkers to interact, to intersect, to identify trends, to identify opportunities, and think through both the problem set and pathways to a solution. This effort and these conferences also push back against a fatalism, and it's a false fatalism that the situation can never be remediated, that the division of the peninsula is a permanent one, that the North Korean nuclear program can never be unwound and eliminated. The artificial division of the peninsula, the attendant dangers are not permanent, should not be permanent, must not be permanent. So what you're doing today, in my view, is helping the U.S. to prepare, helping the ROC prepare, and helping all friends of the Korean people to prepare for the day that we all hope will come soon. So thank you very much. Thank you, Victor.
Thank you, Danny. That was really fantastic, a fantastic statement of what has happened, the policy issues, the priorities, and also the agenda for 2015. Really, thank you very much. I know you have to go, but if you have time for a couple of questions, we'd be quite grateful for that. So I will recognize anyone from the floor. Please ask a question. Don't make a statement. And if you make a statement, I'm going to cut you off. So Joe Bosco.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Thank you for sharing your thoughts with us today. It's great to have you. You mentioned the great dangers emanating from North Korea in terms of both their nuclear and missile program and proliferation, as well as their human rights record. And you talked about multilateral solidarity. But of course, there's one nation that has the greatest influence over North Korea that is not in solidarity with the international community, and that's the People's Republic of China. We saw in the film that the danger that China constantly touts of a migration across the border is not realistic. The real migration would be from North to South Korea. I wonder if you could comment on China's role as a responsible or irresponsible stakeholder in these issues.
Yes, thank you very much. We are hugely mindful, as past administrations have been, of the important role that China plays and must play in managing and ultimately in resolving the myriad of threats posed by the DPRK and their quest for nuclear and nuclear-capable ballistic missile powers. Last month, I sat in the room when both President Obama and President Xi Jinping in Beijing met with the international press. And I was struck by a remarkable commonality in the messages. And that is a commonality between the two presidents and between the U.S. and China that was reflected in those and in other diplomatic meetings as well. The Chinese have made clear, publicly and privately, that they regard North Korea's pursuit of nuclear weapons as a significant threat, that they regard the risk of proliferation and missile development to be destabilizing, and that they are committed to achieving denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Importantly, and increasingly, the signals from China seem to indicate the same skepticism that we hold regarding Kim Jong-un's international effort to convince the world that it should engage economically with the DPRK, but turn a blind eye to the ongoing nuclear program. There is mounting evidence that the Chinese do not consider Pyongyang a workable or a desirable strategy. And there is considerable evidence that the Chinese have manifested their concern and indeed their displeasure with that DPRK policy in very practical ways. I cited one, which was the strategically huge decision by President Xi Jinping to visit Seoul while holding the DPRK at arm's length. But there are others in terms of the management of the borders and the extent of energy and economic assistance to the DPRK that go hand in hand with the U.S. strategy, which is, given that relinquishing its nuclear weapon capabilities or programs may well be the last thing on earth that Kim Jong-un wants to do, it's incumbent on the international community to remove the alternatives and to sharpen the choice so that, reluctant though he may be, embarking on meaningful, credible, authentic negotiations to freeze, to roll back, and to eliminate the nuclear program is the only viable course available to him. So while it's the view of the United States that there is more that China can do by way of applying pressure, and while it's the view of China that there's more that the United States can do by way of diplomatic engagement, I see a broad alignment in strategic interest and a commitment to cooperation on both sides.
Thanks. I think we have time for one more, given his schedule. So, yes. Mike's coming.
Thank you very much. My name is Tatsuya Mizumoto from Juju Press. Regarding the relationship between Japan and Korea, so in order to improve the current bad situation in both countries, so what are you going to expect to your allies, Japan and Korea, in next year?
Well, as I've said, the improvement and the restoration of open, friendly, fully cooperative ties between Japan and the Republic of Korea is a high priority for the United States. That priority drove the decision by President Obama to host an important first ever trilateral summit with President Park and Prime Minister Abe in the spring, when all three leaders were in The Hague for the Nuclear Security Summit. The global economy is too fragile for two major economies in Asia to be at odds. The global and regional security situation is too fraught for two major allies in the Asia Pacific to have anything less than unhindered and full cooperation. And the global agenda is too full for these two leading democracies to do anything other than cooperate and collaborate in an open and unconstrained way. Now, there are serious and painful issues which remain as the legacy of the previous century, issues that must be dealt with. No one party can solve those legacy issues alone. It takes continued and sincere efforts by all concerned to lead to a mutually satisfying resolution that will be durable and that will open the door to the fully unfettered cooperation that the people of Japan, the people of the Republic of Korea, the people of the United States, and in fact, the countries in the region, as well as the global economy, seeks and would benefit from. So, thank you very much. Thanks very much.
Before you applaud, he needs to leave, so I would ask you all to please stay seated, that's including the press, so that he can get out of here. Okay, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking your seats. So we are very happy to hear from Assistant Secretary Russel this morning on a quite substantive speech on Korea. Rarely do we have the opportunity to hear him give a speech specifically on Korea, so we are very grateful for that. And now we'd like to begin the second part of our program with Deputy Secretary Armitage and with, of course, the Minister of Unification, Minister Ryoo. Let me begin by first introducing Deputy Secretary Armitage, who is, as you all know, President of Armitage International. But prior to that, from 2001 to 2005, he served as the United States Deputy Secretary of State. Prior to that, he held many diplomatic positions that covered both East Asia, Southeast Asia, as well as the Middle East, and has been decorated by numerous governments in the world for all of his service on behalf of the United States government and in the promotion of good relations between the United States and a countless number of countries. We're very grateful that he was able to join us this morning. And I will turn the stage over to Deputy Secretary Armitage, who will offer some remarks and introduce the Unification Minister.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cha. Ambassador An, nice to see you again, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, that was quite a good crowd. We've got a heck of a lot better day today than we had yesterday. And now we only have to contend with the wind and not the rain. But the day's going to get better yet when we hear from our guest speaker tonight, a man who, as far as I'm concerned, is the key architect of Mrs. Park's trust politic. You know, it is not a secret that there are some in the United States who are a little skeptical right now of what Mrs. Park is doing with China. Some people here in the United States feel that perhaps there's putting a little distance between the United States and getting closer to China. I myself think this is very good common sense on the part of President Park. They have great economic interests in China, and indeed, she's got great economic interest in engaging the North and standing firm against provocations, but getting China to use what influence they are willing to exert on North Korea. So as I described our speaker this morning as a gentleman who is the key architect of trust politics, and is a man, as far as I can see, whose whole life has been a preparation for this very job. And a BA and MA in political science from Korea University, laterally a PhD in 1995, 20 years ago. He's been a researcher at the Far Eastern Institute of Far Eastern Studies, been an advisor for a previous Minister of Unification, was an advisor for the president in security and foreign policy, has been a professor of North Korean studies. So in a very real way, his whole life has led him to this position. And I can assure you, Minister Ryoo, you're going to have a very interested and engaged I would say, student body here as a former professor. We're not quite students any longer, but you'll find they're as inquisitive, I think, as students. So if I may have the honor of introducing our guest speaker, the Minister of Unification of the Republic of Korea, Dr. Ryoo Kihl-Jae. Yeah.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Ryoo Kihl-Jae, the Minister of Unification of the Republic of Korea. Thank you for the former Deputy Secretary Richard Armitage's his very warm introduction. Thank you. Thank you again. It's my great honor to speak to you at today's Korea Global Forum. President John Hamley, Professor Victor Cha, distinguished guests from the US and abroad, I'm excited to see you all here in Washington, D.C. This city is a very special place for me, as I have many fond memories of Washington. Decades ago, when I was a young scholar studying North Korea, I spent many months in Washington visiting the National Archives almost every day to look through documents captured during the Korean War in order to explore these lost pieces of North Korea history. I've had the opportunity to stay in D.C. Twice since then, and have gotten to know many experts and scholars. Today, I'm glad to see many good old friends here. It means a lot to me for this event to be held here in Washington, D.C., and to have discussions on preparation for Korean unification and Korea-U.S. cooperation. As many of you may know, the Korea Global Forum was launched in 2010 by the Ministry of Unification of the Republic of Korea, with a view to have meaningful and lively discussions with the international community on Korean Peninsula issues. For the last 5 years, many scholars and government officials of various countries have shared their valuable insights in the forum. I believe that today's conference will also be a platform for strategic communication among all of you. Distinguished guests, for the last 2 years, the Parkhune administration has consistently advanced its trust-building process on the Korean Peninsula. The trust-building process was born from a critical retrospection of the history of inter-Korean relations. The two Koreas experienced division and war and have endured mainly constant conflict and confrontation with only momentary instances of dialogue, exchange, and cooperation. There were some occasions when we temporarily moved from conflict and confrontation to dialogue and cooperation, but the fundamental nature of the relations did not change. That is why the ROK government came up with the trust-building process on the Korean Peninsula. Through this policy, we aim to ensure consistency and continuity throughout the process, as well as predictability of our cooperation projects in order to build mutual trust. Although it may take time and North Korea may not be cooperative, it has been 2 years since our government took office, and today there are some people who argue that the trust-building process is not working, inter-Korean relations are not improving, and the ROK government is not playing a leading role in the relations. I do not agree with such criticisms. The root cause of the problem is not the trust-building process itself, but the very nature of inter-Korean relations. Ironically, the North Korean regime's survivability seems based on its existential need for an adversary, which is South Korea. And so, hostility between the two Koreas has lasted for nearly seven decades now. At the same time, the Kim Jong-un regime is only in its third year now. As we can see today, during the transition period, both internal management and outreach are required in a way that helps establish the legitimacy of the new leadership. That is why Pyongyang has repeatedly reached out to Seoul and Washington, only to break its promises and return to provocation since Kim Jong-un took power. Pyongyang's behavior during the time of the Incheon Asian Games in October is a prime example. At the time, top North Korean officials visited the South. I met with them and talked about improving inter-Korean relations. And we agreed to hold another round of high-level talks. However, North Korea did not honor this promise. That is because they took issue with the balloon launching into North Korea by some South Korean NGOs. But these balloons were being launched even before the agreement. North Korea will continue to go back and forth between outreach and provocation in order to ensure the stability of Kim Jong-un's leadership and the continuity of its regime. And that is exactly the reason why the trust-building process on the Korean Peninsula still makes sense and is required. The trust-building process does not adhere to produce short-term achievement. Instead, it aims to correct the wrong practices one by one and change the fundamental nature of inter-Korean relations, even though it might take time. Therefore, the South Korean government will stick to its original intention with a long-term perspective in mind, and we will continue to push ahead the trust-building process. Distinguished guests, the year 2015 will mark the 70th year of the division of the Korean Peninsula. The year 2045, a mere generation later, would mark the 100th year. After such a long time, Korean unification might become a mission impossible. President Park's comparison of unification to a bonanza had the primary intention to boost enthusiasm about unification among the Korean society. For many South Korean people, especially younger citizens, unification is not a very pressing issue. The time to work seriously to change this attitude is now. The South Korean people, as the main actors of unification, should accept their task and have a sense of responsibility before it is too late. It was with this understanding that the Park Geun-hye administration launched the Presidential Committee for Unification Preparation. The committee involves both public and private parties to discuss unification together and make preparations for it. With the launch of the committee, the Park Geun-hye government is further accelerating unification preparation projects across the board. However, I do not believe that unification will be achieved solely by the effort of the Korean people. I believe that only when the international community, including the United States, supports our goal and works together with us for it, the people's dreams of unification will finally come true. Also, the benefits of unification will not be confined to the Korean peninsula. The Korean unification will make tremendous contributions to the peace and prosperity of the Northeast Asian region and the world as a whole. It will provide a new growth momentum for not only the economies of Northeast Asia, but also the global economy by reconnecting Eurasia to the Pacific. Distinguished guests, the Republic of Korea has emerged from the ashes of war and achieved remarkable industrial and democratic development. Throughout our long story of labor and success, which has been admired as the miracle of the Han River, the United States has always been our closest ally and best friend. In particular, the alliance between our two countries provided a strong deterrence against North Korea's provocations and ensured a firm security posture on the peninsula, thereby becoming the key foundation of our policy toward North Korea. Today, the ROK-US alliance is at its best. It has become a truly global partnership, going beyond the Korean Peninsula and the Northeast Asian region. Distinguished guests, on the basis of such a strong alliance, I believe that the Republic of Korea and the United States should now explore more creative and diverse approaches to resolve the Korean Peninsula issue. This issue is not only between the South and North Korean peoples, but it is a global one, directly linked to the national interest of the United States as well as Northeast Asian countries. For the interest of both of our countries, the issues of North Korea's nuclear programs and human rights violations should be tackled now. Of course, both of our countries have experiences of being betrayed at the hands of Pyongyang. For all types of North Korean problems, including nuclear weapons and human rights infringement, it is extremely difficult to find solutions because these problems are directly linked to the very survival of the regime. However, I believe that Seoul and Washington should not be frustrated by the failure of the past and should look for innovative approaches and move forward with patience. By doing so, our two countries will be able to ensure the legitimacy of our policy toward North Korea, thereby encouraging more countries to support our policy and join in our effort. If our two countries agree on a strategic division of work and build a strong cooperative framework involving the whole international community, we may be able to change North Korea's strategic interest. Distinguished guests, let me elaborate briefly on the strategic cooperation between our two countries. Until now, Seoul and Washington focused on inducing Pyongyang to change by cooperatively putting pressure upon it. However, to make the pressure more effective, dialogues and cooperation are also necessary. Our two countries should therefore strengthen our coordination for engagement as well. We will need to show Pyongyang clearly what it can earn by giving up the path of provocation and isolation and choosing the path of dialogue and cooperation. It will be important to help North Korea actually see the benefits of cooperation with South Korea and the international community. This will also be a way to pragmatically improve the quality of life and the human rights situation of the North Korean people. If Seoul and Washington each fulfill their roles for these shared goals, I'm confident that we can bear tangible fruits. distinguished guests, the Park Geun-hye administration is preparing for unification with an aim to make not only South and North Koreans, but the whole global society happier in and with a unified Korea. Personally, I like to put it this way. We need to get three wheels turning together to achieve a unification that will serve for people's happiness. One wheel means improving the inter-Korean relations, and another one is building consensus on unification among the South Korean society. These two wheels are certainly important. However, the third wheel, which represents cooperation with the international community, is also critical. For the unification of the Korean peninsula, more than anything else, participation of the international community, including the United States, in the process of unification preparation is indispensable. If we look at history, I believe German unification was possible thanks to the close cooperation of the international community, including the U.S. If Washington strongly supports and assists Korean unification, I believe that we will be able to make the dreams of both of our countries, dreams of a unified Korea, peace in Northeast Asia, and shared prosperity of the whole world, all come true. Let me end by saying that in today's discussions, I hope that you explore many practical ways to improve inter-Korean relations and to upgrade the coordination framework for North Korean policy between our two countries. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Minister, for a very substantive and profound speech. We really do appreciate it. The minister has agreed to take some questions. He delivered his speech in English, but we have the aid of an able interpreter to take any questions that you might have for him. So if you could just identify yourself, and as we did this morning, please, no statements, just a question, that would be greatly appreciated. Yes, David.
Hi, David.
Wait for the mic, David.
Thank you. Very encouraging remarks. Could you comment on the status of President Park Geun-hye's good efforts to build a Northeast Asia regional peace and security mechanism, and how neighbors like Mongolia, President Elbedorge's good neighbor policy and efforts to build a Ulaanbaatar dialogue, and obviously very trusted by both North and South Korea, might be a help to her efforts to build a Northeast Asia peace and security mechanism.
Let me speak in Korean with the help of the very good translator. 그 사실 한반도 문제에 있어서 그 저는 그 미국의 협력 저는 이것을 단순히 협력 이상이라고 생각을 합니다. 미국과의 지금까지 60년 동안 한미 동맹 을 통해서 한반도의 그 안보가 유지가 돼 왔고 특히 그 토대 위에서 한국은 그야말로 기적을 이루는 그런 성과를 거뒀습니다. 산업화와 민주화를 우리는 성공적으로 마쳤습니다. 저는 그러한 한미 간의 그 강력한 동맹이 앞으로 우리가 통일을 이뤄내는 데 있어서도 역시 가장 중요한 자산이라고 생각을 합니다.
First of all, thank you for your question. For the Korean Peninsula issues and And I think the cooperation of the United States actually means something more than just the cooperation. For the last 6 years, the ROK-US alliance has kept the security on the Korean Peninsula. And on that basis, South Korea has achieved a real miracle. We both successfully achieved economic development and has built a vibrant democracy. And I believe that for the next mission of unification as well, the ROK-US alliance will be a key asset.
한미 간의 긴밀한 그런 동맹관계의 토대 위에서, 그것의 기초 위에서 저는 동북아에 있는 여러 나라들과의 협력이 가능하고 또한 효율적으로 될 것이라고 생각을 합니다.
And on that basis of a strong alliance between Seoul and Washington, I believe that the cooperation with other Northeast Asian countries is possible and it will be even more effective.
동북아에 있는 나라들과 같이 협력하는 데 있어서 여러 가지 부문을 우리는 생각할 수 있을 것 같습니다. 특히 경제적인 측면에서는 최근에 우리가 나진아산 그 프로젝트에서 보는 것과 같이 남북 러 간의 이런 협력을 할 수가 있을 것이고 또 앞으로 향후에는 남북 중 간에도 좀 할 수 있을 거라고 봅니다. 당장은 일본과 같이 할 수 있는 일이 지금 저희가 하고 있는 일은 없지만 그러나 저는 단기간 내에는 남북 일도 저는 할 수 있고 그 이외의 조합들도 저는 가능하다고 생각을 합니다.
We can think of many ways and many areas of cooperation with the Northeast Asian countries. For example, we can build a framework of South Korea, North Korea, and Russian cooperation, the triangular cooperation, and the project is going on in Rajin and Hassan is a very good example of this triangular cooperation. We can also think of cooperation involving China with the two Koreas. And with Japan, there is no ongoing project right now, but in the near term, I believe that the cooperation project between Japan and the two Koreas is also possible.
저는 뭐 역사를 깊이 배우진 않았습니다만 그 역사 속에서 특히 1945년에 그 한반도가 해방이 됐을 때 그때 그 당시에 소련의 그 대한반도 정책을 공부를 하면서 우리 주위에 있는 나라들이 한반도가 자신들에게 어떠한 나라여야 되는가 자신들의 국가 이익에 어떤 나라여야 되는가를 얼만큼 진지하게 생각하는지에 대해서 본 바가 있습니다.
And I'm not personally a historian, but I studied a little bit about the Korean Peninsula policy of the Soviet Union in the era of the freedom from the Japanese liberation in 1945. And I observed how the neighboring countries thought seriously about what kind of a country Korea should become for their interest.
한반도 통일이라고 하는 것은 동북아의 질서를 굉장히 근본적으로 바꾸는 그런 일이 될 것이기 때문에 우리 주위에 있는 나라들의 입장에서 볼 때는 자신들의 그 국가 이익에 심대한 영향을 미치는 것으로 볼 거라고 생각합니다.
The Korean unification will fundamentally change the order in the Northeast Asia. So for many Northeast Asian countries, it will have a significant impact in their national interest.
그렇기 때문에 그 나라들의 국가 이익을 국가 이익에 통일이라고 하는 것이 부합할 수 있다라고 하는 것을 분명하게 보여줄 수 있어야 되고 저는 그렇게 분명하게 보여줄 수 있는 길은 그 나라들과 통일하는 과정에서 그 나라들과 긴밀하게 협력을 하고 어쩌면은 통일의 과정 속에 그 나라들의 참여도 저는 있어야 된다고 생각을 합니다.
So it will be very important to ensure that the Korean unification will be also in their interest, and it will be important to clearly show to the neighboring countries. So in order to do that, I think it is very important to ensure a close cooperation with the neighboring countries, and it will be also important to involve the neighboring Northeast Asian countries in the process of Korean unification.
그런 점에서 지금부터 우리는 주위에 있는 나라들과 경제적으로 또 사회적으로 여러 가지 부문에서 같이 협력하는 것이 장차 그 통일을 통일에 있어서 주위에 있는 국가들이 지지할 수 있게 만드는 실질적인 길이라고 저는 생각을 합니다.
So I believe that it will be important to ensure a close economic and social exchange and cooperation with the neighboring countries in order to ensure their support in the process of unification.
그것이 바로 한반도 신뢰 프로세스와 동북아 평화협력 구상 그리고 유라시아 이니셔티브들이 다 연결되는 그런 배경이라고 말씀드릴 수 있습니다.
And I can say that that point is the commonality between the many South Korean initiatives, including the trust building process, the Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative, and the Eurasia initiatives. Thank you.
Hello, thank you, Minister Chen Weihua, China Daily. You talk about the importance of dialogue. But now the dialogue is in a stalemate, going nowhere. So the U.S. had laid out the preconditions for dialogue. I mean, can you talk about how flexible South Korea is willing to resume, say, six-party dialogue, and how important the six-party dialogue is to you? Thank you.
Yes, 네, 질문 감사드립니다. 이 언론에서 그 옷이 많이들 계신 것 같은데 이 장관이 되고 나서 가장 그 긴장하면서 제가 답을 해야 될 부분들이 바로 이제 언론을 그 기자분들의 그 답인 것 같습니다.
Thank you for your question. I think that there are a lot of journalists here today as well, and every time I am in front of the journalist, I get the most nervous since I become the minister.
6자 회담의 조건은 지금 현재로 봐서는 그 뭐 북한도 그렇고 또 우리 한국과 미국의 입장도 지금 이렇게 크게 조정되지 않고 있는 상황입니다. 앞으로 어떻게 할 것이냐? 뭐 이 부분은 여러 가지 좀 같이 얘기를 좀 해봐야 될 것 같습니다. 특히 한국과 미국 간에도 얘기를 좀 긴밀히 해야 될 것 같고 제가 이번에 미국에 온 이유가 미국과 6자 회담을 재개하기 위한 무슨 협의를 하기 위해서 온 것은 아닙니다.
As for the precondition for resumption of the six-party talks, no substantial matching point has been found between North Korea and South Korea and the United States. So I believe that there must be a lot of more discussions to find the matching point. And of course, even though this is not my specific visit purpose of visit to the United States.
그렇기 때문에 제가 뭐 여기서 이렇게 구체적으로 드릴 수 있는 말씀은 없고 다만 좀 큰 틀에서 이 북핵 문제를 해결하기 위한 우리 주위에 있는 나라들의 좀 더 긴밀한 그런 협의가 필요한 시점이 아닌가 이 정도만 제가 말씀드리겠습니다.
So it won't be very appropriate to give a very specific comment about this question, but I can say that on the broader, from the broader perspective, the time to ensure a close cooperation of neighboring countries for the resumption of the six-party talks has come. So that is what I can say at this moment.
특히 저는 이번에 제가 미국에 오면서 미국 한국과 미국 간에 긴밀한 그 협의가 또 의사소통이 저는 가장 중요한 요인이라고 생각을 합니다. 그렇기 때문에 그런 점 때문에 이번에 미국에 왔다 이렇게 말씀드리고 싶습니다.
Especially the close communication and coordination between South Korea and the United States is the most important, and that is one of the reasons why I am here.
Next question. Yes, Mike.
Michael Marshall, Global Peace Foundation. Sir, you said earlier that Korean unification would affect the national interests of all the neighboring countries. I wonder what argument you would make to the PRC, to China, to convince them that unification would be in their national interests. They may perceive their national interests to be best served by undertaking an economic colonization of North Korea while maintaining the political division. Thank you.
I personally believe that just persuading to the neighboring countries that South Korean unification will be also your interest won't be enough in ensuring their support.
통역을 할 수 있을지 모르겠는데 우리 한국 속담에 백문이 불여 일견이라는 말이 있습니다.
There is a South Korean saying that goes, "You better see first than asking thousands of questions."
아까 제가 말씀드린 것처럼 그 실제로 우리 주위에 있는 나라들이 한반도가 통일되는 과정, 한반도가 통일되는 그 과정이라고 하는 그 표현이 사실은 굉장히 이렇게 클 수가 있는데. 굉장히 여러 가지 아주 그 광범위한 의미를 담고 있을 수가 있기 때문에 좀 더 설명이 필요하긴 합니다만 좀 이렇게 넓게 봐서 한반도가 통일되는 그 과정에서 주위에 있는 국가들이 함께 같이 참여를 해서 주로 아마 경제적인 협력들이 많이 되겠습니다만 저는 꼭 경제적인 협력만으로 국한시키고 싶지는 않습니다. 그러나 좀 더 이해를 돕기 위해서는 경제적인 협력을 함께 하게 되면 그걸 통해서 전 주위에 있는 국가들이 자신들에게 이득이 된다라고 하는 것을 체감을 할 수 있을 거예요. 단순히 느끼는 것을 넘어서서 이익을 볼 수 있다, 볼 수 있게 되면 그런 과정과 경험들이 축적이 되면 그런 것들이 저는 그 나라들로 하여금 자발적으로 한반도 통일을 지지할 수 있게 만들 수 있을 거라고 봅니다.
So the important thing is to really show to the neighboring countries. The process of Korean unification that will be interested in their countries as well. The process really can mean a lot, but it will be important to involve the neighboring countries in the process of unification by having them participate in, for example, many economic cooperation projects, but not confined to economic cooperation. So By doing so, we can really show the neighboring countries that the South Korean unification with North Korea will be in their interest and it will be beneficial for them as well. And with such experience, I believe that the neighboring countries will become voluntarily supportive to South Korean unification.
제가 통일부 장관으로서 그 제가 하고 있는 일이 제가 아까도 그 말씀 중에도 들어가 있습니다만 이제 창의적인 방식이 좀 필요하다고 봅니다. 지금 기존에 있는 그 틀을 가지고서 한반도 통일 문제를 접근하게 되면 여러 가지로 제약이 되는 요소들이 더 많이 보일 거라고 생각이 됩니다. 창의적인 생각 그리고 좀 더 과감한 그 이 행동이 저는 통일을 우리가 준비하는 데 있어서 굉장히 필요한 그런 가치, 덕목이라고 저는 생각을 합니다.
As the Minister of Unification of the Republic of Korea, my job requires really a creative approach because there are so many obstacles in the conventional framework of doing the things. So the creative thinking and courageous action are a very important key value in the process of unification.
Next question. Yes, right here. No, right here. This gentleman right here.
Yes, thank you. It strikes me that one of the
Should
most
identify
important.
Identify yourself first.
Of course, I'm Tom Tashi from Princeton University, and it strikes me that one of the most important ingredients here in any effort to convince the stakeholders. Try this again.
It seems to me that the most important ingredient, in any plan to convince these countries that unification is in their interest, is information. One of the biggest barriers here is uncertainty over what would happen in the case of unification. And so, to the extent that, you know, that is the case, how do we go about increasing, you know, our understanding of what's going on in North Korea, getting reliable information and reliable data so that we can convince countries that unification might be an answer?
Princeton 대학이면 굉장히 좋은 우리 저는 이제 저 전공이 원래 비교 정치 comparative politics를 공부를 했는데 이 프린스턴 대학의 comparative politics가 얼마나 강한지를 제가 잘 알고 있습니다.
Thank you for the very good question from the Princeton University. I studied the comparative politics and I know how strong your universities are in this field.
북한에 대한 정보는 여전히 그 신뢰할 만한 그 정보를 우리가 얻기는 여전히 어렵습니다. 그건 분명히 사실인 것 같습니다.
It is clear that it is still very difficult to get the reliable information about North Korea.
그렇지만 최근엔 이제 북한도 그 많은 사람들이 밖으로 나와서 노동을 하고 있고 물론 이제 노동 인력 송출이라고 저희가 얘기하고 있는 그런 일이 있고 또 제한돼 있긴 하지만 점진적으로 이렇게 외부 세계하고 많이 접하는 그런 것들을 통해서 과거보다는 북한 내부의 그 상황을 아는 것이 좀 더 수월해졌다고 말씀드릴 수 있습니다.
But these days there is a so-called export of labor from North Korean side, and North Korea is still limited, but it is expanding its contact with the outside world. So in comparison to the past, it is a little bit easier than before to get what to know about what is going on in North Korea.
그러나 여전히 뭐 우리 한국 사람들 같은 경우에는 물론 지금 북한을 자유로 갈 수가 없지만 외국 분들은 아마 북한을 가는 게 그래도 좀 쉬울 거라고 생각을 합니다. 그러나 북한을 간다고 하더라도 거기를 방문한다고 하더라도 실제로 북한에서 벌어지고 있는 일을 알기는 쉽지가 않고 북한에 들어가서도 역시 그 정보를 얻기는 쉽지 않은 외부 세계에 대해서도 폐쇄적이지만 그 안의 세계에서도 굉장히 그 폐쇄적인 그런 국가가 바로 북한입니다.
And there are some countries where the residents can visit North Korea relatively easily in comparison to the South Korean visitors. But even though you visit North Korea, you cannot really get the information you want because North Korean society is not only close to the external world, but it's also close to the outside, to the inside.
그래서 저는 제 학생들에게 그런 걸 권합니다. 북한을 지금 현재의 모습만 보지 말고 과거에서부터 쭉 이어져 내려왔던 그 북한의 역사적인 궤적을 트러젝토리를 이렇게 쭉 한번 보는 것이 현재 북한에 대해서 우리가 얻지 못하는 것들로부터 지금 현재는 우리가 얻지 못하지만 그 역사적인 궤적을 통해서 보게 되면 현재 북한의 모습이 이렇게 인비전 할 수 있는 그렇게 될 수 있는 그런 공부가 있을 수 있다고 얘기를 합니다.
So what I recommend to my students is to observe the past of North Korea to understand the present of North Korea, to follow the trajectory of history of North Korea. So it will help you to envision what we cannot obtain, what we cannot get to know at this point.
북한에 대한 정보 가 부족하고 그래서 북한을 잘 알지 못하고 북한이 무슨 생각을 하는지를 우리가 이해하기가 어렵고 하는 이런 부분들이 분명히 있지만 저는 중요한 것은 우리가 상대해야 되는 북한보다는 우리가 북한을 어떻게 할 것인가 하는 점이 중요하다고 생각을 합니다.
Of course, it is true that we lack information on North Korea. It is difficult to understand what North Korea is about and what it really thinks of. But I believe that what is important is to how is about how we deal with North Korea.
Yes, right here we got a question.
Thank you, Professor. I'm visiting fellow.
Where's the mic?
Thank you, Professor Cha. Yeah, I'm Baijie from CSIS. I'm President Fellow of the Freeman Chair. I'm from China. Thank you for informative presentation. My question is, you know, actually I followed the Korean Peninsula situation for several years, and President Park Geun-hye, he tabled the unification bonanza, but also she mentioned about the paradox in Northeast Asia, of course, including the Asian the region, because economically, a lot of countries relying on the United States and economically relying on China. My question is also focusing on the regional cooperation. You know, recently China tabled proposed a lot of, you know, just like one road, one belt, and the regional cooperation in economic affairs. So my question goes to, you mentioned a lot of, you know, the cooperation and the security affairs, but in the future, I think the regional cooperation economic area can also bring a very positive impact to the, you know, unification process of Korean peninsula. So how do you think about, you know, the future regional cooperation will bring some bring the impacts to the unification of the Korean Peninsula, and how do you dealing with the relations between the United States and China? So I can explain in Korean maybe if you permit. Yeah. Okay, we can do that. Okay. Thank you. Can you understand?
지금은 저희가 역시 이것도 남북 중 간의 어떤 협력 사업 같은 것들은 아직은 진행되고 있는 것은 없습니다만 계속해서 여러 가지 구상들이 있고 그래서 남북 중 그런 협력 사업들도 가능하게 되고 실현이 되면 역시 중국과의 그 협력이 좀 더 이렇게 분명한 모습들을 드러낼 거라고 생각이 됩니다.
Thank you for your very, very broad questions that requires a long-term perspective. And it is true that South Korea needs the cooperation and help of the neighboring countries to achieve unification. And China is really important because it is geopolitically close to the Korean Peninsula. And of course, there is no ongoing project between the two Koreas and China, but there are many projects being discussed. And if they are materialized, we can really see how the cooperation between two Koreas and China will look like.
미국과 중국의 관계는 한반도 문제뿐만이 아니라 여러 가지 측면에서 미국과 중국의 그 관계가 그 결정될 거라고 봅니다. 영향을 받는다고 저는 생각을 합니다. 비단 한반도 문제뿐만이 아니라.
The relations with the United States and China are not only influenced by the Korean Peninsula issue, there are many factors that have impact on these relations.
한반도 통일은 미국과 중국의 협력이 협력적인 그런 분위기가 굉장히 중요한 배경이 될 수 있다고 봅니다. 그것이 결정적인 전 이유라고 결정적인 요소라고 생각하진 않지만 그러나 미국과 중국의 협력이 한반도 통일을 이루는 데 있어서 굉장히 우호적인 그런 조건이 좀 될 수 있다고 생각을 합니다.
For the Korean unification, I believe that the cooperative atmosphere between the United States and China is very important. I don't think it is really critical, but certainly the close cooperation between the United States and China will help create a very favorable atmosphere for Korean unification.
그래서 앞으로 한국이 우리 주위에 있는 나라들 지정학적으로 가까운 중국이라든가 러시아라든가 일본이라든가 이런 나라들과 협력하는 과정에서 늘 미국과 협력적인 그런 분위기를 갖는 것이 저는 필요하고 한국은 그런 방향으로 앞으로 노력을 해갈 생각입니다. 우리가 만약에 한국이 역할을 해서 미국과 중국의 관계를 협력적으로 만들 수 있다면 그런 방향으로 우리는 노력을 할 것입니다.
So I believe that it will be important in our future cooperation with China, Russia, and other close neighbors. It will be important for us to maintain our close coordination with the United States, and that will be the direction of how we work in the future. So it will be important to for Korea to be able to play a role in creating a cooperative atmosphere between the U.S. and China.
Mr. Minister, we want to thank you for taking the time to spend with us. I know you have many meetings here while you're in Washington. And I would like to say that, as Deputy Secretary Armitage said, we certainly understand that you are the architect of President Park's policies. And if we ever forget that, Ambassador An is always here to remind us who is the true architect of the policies. So thank you very much for joining us this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you could stay seated until the minister leaves, we'd appreciate it.